Thank you very much. About the name, it was nobody's fault. It was the office secretary at the BBC where I worked for about 10 years. She couldn't understand that some of us can have a surname that comes before the given name. So I said, okay, do it the way you like it, you know. So she just put it that way, and I've lived with the name since. You know, small confusions, you know, sometimes happen. Delightful stories, nonetheless. I'm going to attempt something very brave and probably fail. 62 years of history of Kashmir, of the Kashmir conflict in 15 minutes. My history teacher is going to die. And I need to put a timer on this phone, yes. This is not Gaza. This is a what's called a crackdown in early 90s in Srinagar, Kashmir's capital. A crackdown would be an operation by the armed forces where they would make an announcement early in the morning, soon after the morning prayers, from the same mosque, and ask you to leave your houses and gather in an open space, a street in this case, or a school compound, or a hospital ground, or any open space, where you would sit all day like this, and so that they could conduct searches, you know, around the area. It would be a siege, is the proper word for it. And you would sit there all day and, you know, do nothing and basically curse these people for, if for nothing else, but for making your bum so tired and, you know, bruised. I was once in a crackdown, and most of us, I grew up in Kashmir in the 90s, I was a teenager, and most of us have been in many crackdowns. Most of them would last a day, but some would carry on till the next day and the day after, 3 days. You would have to do this every day, sit there, do nothing, while armed forces surrounded your area, conducted searches and looking for militants and arms or whatever else, and you were supposed to do this. I was once in a crackdown near my maternal home in downtown Srinagar. Srinagar, as I said, the capital, is a very old city. In the old town is my mother's home, and my mother was in the hospital, which was close to my maternal home. So I was living with my maternal relatives because it would be easier for me to go to the hospital every day with food and, you know, other things. And so one morning you have this sinister announcement we recognize, you know, very well. And you would get bored as well. You would say, oh, there they go again. Now we have to go out and, you know, sit there all day. So the announcement comes and I go and I stay in. We go to the college I used to go to, actually, you know. And I was in this, you know, in the college lawns where we sat and sat and sat and sat, but I was getting slightly impatient. I was 16, 17, I think, because I had to go to the hospital to take food, the daily lunch for my mother. So in a brave act, I just stood up and screamed out to this officer, a person who looked like an officer, and said, look, I need to talk to you. And I spoke in English. I don't know why. Probably, you know, he would have listened. And it did work. And he said, okay, what is the issue here? And I explained, look, I have to go to the hospital and I can't stay here all day, you know. You can conduct your searches and look for weapons and arms. I don't have any. I'm a student in this very college. Can I go? He was considerate, you know, probably a very educated army officer. And he let me go. But he asked one of his soldiers to write me a curfew pass. Because in these operations, the area under consideration is also under curfew, shoot-at-sight orders mostly. So he wrote me a scribble on my hand and said, you know, go. So I went home, picked the stiffened carrier and, you know, food, and wandered, walked through these lanes and by-lanes of the old city on way to the hospital. It was the scariest walk of my life because completely deserted, only bunkers and army checkposts and armored vehicles and machine guns, of course. But I managed to walk until I reached a checkpost where, you know, they had to body search me, and they searched me, you know, they searched your clothes and everything. And this silly soldier, he insisted on also checking my food. And I was trying to explain to him, and I remember I found myself explaining the ingredients of these preparations. It was rice, it was yogurt, and it was dal, lentil soup. But he was determined that he must search his food. So I remember him dipping his, I would like to believe, greasy, dirty fingers, you know, in the food meant for my mother. And he let me go after that because he didn't find any TNT in the yogurt. And so I go to the hospital. Obviously, I threw the food away and, you know, didn't tell anything about that. So this happened every day in the early 90s. Early 90s is a time when 1989 is the precise year when the armed insurgency, this armed separatist movement against Indian rule in Kashmir starts. 90s was like that. You know, the only response that the Indian state could kind of think of at the time, because it was very big. You know, before 1989, it was relatively peaceful. There was obviously the political backdrop, as you know, many of you would know. The conflict goes back to 1947 when, like many cases, when the British left and they left this conflict, unresolved. Kashmir was left undecided, and the word was that it will be decided later between India and Pakistan via a referendum, which hasn't happened. So that's a small bit of history. So 89, there's an armed movement against Indian rule in Kashmir, and this is from that time. And so it was a very, very brutal time. You know, violence was so banal that it was, you know, it got boring at one point, as I remember this. You know, and it takes you years and years to kind of process what happened to you, what happens in your teenage. It's been 20 years since this scene, nearly 20 years. And in those 20 years in Kashmir, to give you, statistics briefly, some staggering statistics, 70,000 people have been killed since this day. And about 8,000 people are what we call as enforced disappearances. And there are also thousands of orphans and thousands of people in Indian prisons, which is the last 20 years. And many people know about the recent history in Kashmir. So 20 years have left a very brutalized, traumatized population in Kashmir, my home. My parents live there. My entire family still lives there. But then you grow up and you begin to process these things and you begin to make sense of what happened. After these 20 years, there's been a big transformation in the last few years, beginning in 2008, 2009, 2010, where the armed movement of the 90s, of that decade, is now transformed into a civilian uprising against Indian state. This photograph, I ask people, where do you think this could be from? And most people think it's the Arab Spring, or Gaza. It's actually a town in Kashmir called Baramulla, North Kashmir, where this young boy is basically, defiant and then wants to kind of tell something to these soldiers in an armed vehicle. This is 2010. But tragically, the response of the Indian state to this new phase of the Kashmiri separatist movement, which is civilian, political, almost an intellectual movement as well, was the same as the 90s, a brutal crackdown, a brutal military response, suppression. So 120 people were killed on the streets of Kashmir, exactly like in the many Arab Spring countries in 2010. That's just a year ago. And most of them were young people, this boy's age. The youngest was 9 years old. I remember his name, Samir, who was outside his house with a cricket bat chanting slogans, because the big boys were chanting slogans, pro-freedom and, Kashmir wants independence and India should go back and so on and so forth. And he, because he's young, so he started, chanting slogans as well. And a vehicle passed by, they just dragged him out, hit him with rifle butts, left him on the curb, and he died. He was bludgeoned to death. Now this thing has happened, and Kashmiris have been wondering that if this happens here, there was the curfew in 2010 when this was happening, when 120 people were killed, lasted about 70 days in all, which is more than 2 months. And I was, you are an expat, you have, the immigrants' home anxiety is multiplied because you're talking to your family every day, asking them how they cope and everything, and they were fine. They said, look, we've used to this, we've stocked food and everything. It'll last us, probably another few weeks, and then, the curfew will go. But when you're away and you live in London and you're in this comfortable life, in somewhere in North London, West London, you feel strange, you feel guilty for some, for reasons that are not of your doing. And so I was talking about the legacy of the conflict is these people who died in 2010, 120 people. There was not enough coverage of it in the Indian media, nor in the international press. And Kashmiris begin to wonder, is it to do with oil? And I tell my Kashmiri friends, be thankful that you don't have oil, because they won't leave if they come in, so this, the 20 years of conflict, I want to go back. I was talking about disappeared people. These are the mothers or the sisters or the wives of disappeared boys, Kashmir disappeared boys, 8,000 of them. And they've been protesting. They have a symbolic protest every month in this park in Srinagar where they tie headbands with a blank outline of a photo on their forehead, obviously representing the disappeared son or brother or everything. And nothing has happened. The local government and the Indian state basically uses the same tactics of obfuscation and denial that we don't know. The people who died in the mountains were all militants. But these people basically, they say these are sons, innocent people who were picked up from their houses and they never came back. They were picked up in the crackdowns I mentioned, some of these people. Because I remember when, you know, if people were picked up during an operation if the informer in the vehicle didn't like his face, or thought he was actually involved in militant activities or was a militant, some of them would never come back. So this protest happens every month, and there are about 8,000 of them, according to, you know, human rights organizations and everything. This is, you know, 2010 and, you know, a year before that and everything. In 2011, something very, very interesting happened. A human rights group appointed by the government, a semi-government institution called SHRC, State Human Rights Commission of Jammu and Kashmir, they carried out an extensive investigation into these allegations and accusations of unnamed graves in the mountains of Kashmir. And the report mentioned 5,000 of these unmarked graves in the mountains of Kashmir, many of them mass graves. Again, Kashmiris, including me, were very angry because they begin to wonder that if these mass graves were made by Saddam Hussein, or if these graves were made in Tripoli, there would be more of an international outrage. There wasn't. I remember. We covered it. I was still with the BBC. I've since quit. We covered this story quite, you know, as well as we could, but there was not enough of it, you know, anywhere else. The reasons are obvious. You know, India is a democracy. The divisions, in the Arab Spring, you see a clear autocrat or a maniacal dictator versus the will of the people. India is a democracy and largely a functioning democracy, but obviously it has huge black holes in that narrative, Kashmir being one of them. It doesn't function as a democracy in Kashmir. And I like to believe it actually functions without a moral and legal system in Kashmir, where there are no answers to these questions. You know, where did these people go? And some of these families have proof that these boys were innocent. And even if they were combatants, you don't, you know, put them in mass graves somewhere. And so this is the legacy of the conflict is this, you know, complete brutalization of these people. And personally, I remember my teenage, you know, it's soul crushing. You know, you don't know what's going to happen. And thankfully, I left. Otherwise, you never know. My parents were very happy when I left in 1993 to study and go to Delhi. And there's also, you know, there are absurd sides to the conflict. It becomes completely crazy sometimes. I once remember there was a ban on the pillion rider. You know, you were not allowed to have an extra rider on your bike. And I was going to tuitions with my friend on a bicycle which was slightly bigger than a children's bike. You know, we were very young. And this huge military man with a mustache, handlebar mustache to kind of, you know, to complete the picture, chased us down this alley. And we stopped and basically and hit me because my friend, lovely, he just left the cycle and me and ran. So it's absurd, you know. I mean, I did laugh about it. I said, what did he think we're going to do, you know, on this really tiny bicycle? Those things kind of, you know, happen. This is, again, 2010, because, as I said, when Kashmir is a slightly, you know, traditional society. Women don't really do this very often, you know. They will do this only when really pushed, you know, to the wall. These are Kashmiri mothers, because 110 people died, as I said, some of them were 15, 16-year-old school children. They came out on the streets with stones and you know, wanted to protest. I want to go back and is there a, to my, you know, to 2010, I called, as I said, I was anxious here in London, worried about my family. I spoke to my father and said how they're coping. And one of the stories he told me was he goes to get milk at 12 at night. the milkman, the local milkman, has a rendezvous point in the area because the area is under siege. You're not allowed to move. So he comes at midnight, and people queue up at night to fetch milk. And I was very angry. I said, you know, surely this is no way to live. This is a complete denial of dignity. And I was furious, as I said, you know, you're away, and you say, I'll do this and I'll do that. And a couple of weeks later, I saw this photo. It came, you know, in the wires. Because, as I said, I was working with the BBC. This was a man protecting the dead body of his son in when, you know, chased away by the security, by these people. And I felt better about my father because I thought he actually has a happy life compared to this. This is a man who was carrying his son's dead body after he was killed in the protest to a funeral with his friends. And they charged down this lane and, you know, this is what happened. And I actually felt thankful, I shouldn't have, that my father's worries are only limited to milk, you know, to which he somehow manages. This is obviously a very disturbing photograph. It stayed in my mind. And so there we are. I mean, I haven't given the entire history of the Kashmir conflict, but it's a completely brutalized population, and people are still waiting for India and Pakistan to talk to them. That's the central problem. 62 years, it's still stuck in this bilateralism that we must decide this territorial dispute, while as Kashmiris, including me, have been saying, it is not a territorial dispute, it is about these people. You have to talk to them. And unless they talk to the Kashmiri people, we're going to see scenes like this, probably more brutal and more violent. And it can flare up any time. The smallest excuse, protest against a power breakdown or a cricket match, turns into a massive anti-India demonstration in 15 minutes in Kashmir. And it can flare up again unless they talk to Kashmiris, and because it is their future, it's at stake. But yes, it's been India's intransigence over the last 62 years. They've been saying it's an integral part. Kashmir says, Pakistan says it's our jugular vein. They're not talking to the people, you know, who they claim as their integral part or something. I'll end there.